Today, I want to look at the fact that Jesus is the beginning. He's our beginning. But as I was going through the scriptures last night, Jesus is our beginning, he's our middle, he's our end, he's our everything. And we don't realize often how much we have that is by the Lord's hand. Paul said to the Corinthians, what do you have that you did not receive? And if you have received it, why do you boast as if you had not received it? And what he's saying is that whatever gifts you have, or whatever knowledge you have, or whatever the things are that you boast in, it was a gift. It was just a gift. So you can't act as if it originated with you, as if you're so clever and you're so smart and you're so gifted. It was all a gift. It's from God's hand. I just want to turn to Genesis 1 verse 1. And it's a scripture we read many, many, many times. It's one of the most well-known scriptures across the world. People know this. That says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And when I am reading through scripture, many, many times I don't do this. And I'm challenged to do this. But the challenge is, Jesus, where are you in the scripture? To actually see Jesus. Because the whole word of God is pointing to him. Jesus said to the Pharisees of his day that they were rejoicing in the scriptures, but he said, but these point of me, and you won't come to me that you would have life. You think in this you have life, which is true, there's life in here, but there's only life in here because it points to Jesus who is the life. So this, I like the way Jacob Presch puts it. The Bible is Jesus in print, and Jesus is the Bible in flesh. It's all about him. And Jesus is right there in the first word of Scripture. Not even the first verse, the first word of Scripture, Jesus is right there. And you kind of wonder, well, how? How do we see that Jesus is there? And sometimes I really like looking at some things that some Jewish scholars have written about Scripture. Not that for me it carries any authority. Doesn't carry any weight in and of itself. I just find it interesting. What I also find interesting is the way that the New Testament handles the Old Testament, the people in the New Testament when they wrote, is different to the way we read the Old Testament. And one of the things that is employed in the New Testament was a term called Gezerah Shewa, which means, it basically means verbal analogy. So if you find one word in one part of Scripture, and that same word is in another part of Scripture, you have to ask, does one have the bearing on the other, even though the context of each Scripture might be very different? And so we find we do this, even though we don't realize it. When we see the word rock in the Bible, we're thinking, does this tell us about Jesus? Because Jesus is the rock. That is verbal analogy. They carried the rock through the wilderness. Or that's what comes through in the letter to the Corinthians. God sent water out of the rock. Because Jesus said, upon this rock I will build my church, referring to himself. Therefore, because it's a rock, it's possibly saying something about Jesus. And under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Paul writes about the rock that followed them in the wilderness, that out of which came life-giving water, was actually Jesus. It spoke of Jesus. It's a different way of reading the Old Testament than we're used to, because we just read it as a story. But there's far more that God is communicating than just the facts of that story, even though we have to understand the facts of that story so we don't misinterpret it. Once we have that established, oh, there was a real rock in the wilderness out of which real water flowed, Once we've got that established, we understand it in its context, then we're wondering, Lord, but what are you teaching us? When Jewish rabbis read the first verse, they say in Hebrew it starts by saying Bereshit bara Elohim et hashamayim ve'et ha'aretz. In the beginning created God the heavens and the earth. They wondered about this word Bereshit, and they said it begins with the second letter of the Hebrew alphabet. And they discussed, why does it start with the second letter of the alphabet and not the first? And there were different stories. One of the stories was because God, if you notice, the first two words, Bereshit, bara, starts with a bait and a resh. And it's those who are doing Hebrew will appreciate this. The two letters that are fundamental in the word baruch, which means blessing. So God started it with a bait because he wanted to bring blessing to all of creation. That's the way the Hebrew mind is thinking as it's studying through scripture. It also looks at the idea that, they look at the idea that the Aleph, they say the Aleph turn around to God and say, what about me? Why don't I start? I'm the first letter. And God says to the Aleph, then you will start the Ten Commandments. Because God says, I am the Lord your God, Anochi, beginning with the Aleph. That's the Jewish mind. Now, what's really interesting is this. When we start to think that way, in the light, not in the light of Jewish understanding, but in the light of what the New Testament teaches clearly, the word opens up different dimensions to our understanding. Because the Aleph is the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet, and those who are doing Hebrew, what numerical value does it have? One. It is a letter that stands for strength and the first, and it has a whole load of meanings attached to it, and it really does relate to God himself in numerous ways. One, the Lord your God is one. He's one God. He's also, it relates to God because God is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the Aleph and the Tav. It relates to him. So it doesn't start with Aleph. Why? Because God precedes the beginning. He is eternal. Do you get that? But also, God is the beginning. It's in Isaiah 44, verse 6. And this is very important when we're thinking of Jesus. Now, this is very good. Okay. God says this to Israel. Verse 6. Thus says the Lord, the God of the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. I am the first and I am the last, and there is no God beside me. Who is like me? Let him proclaim and declare it. In other words, there is no one else who is like the one who is the beginning and the end. Even Michael, the archangel, cannot be designated the first and the last. And his name means Michael, the one who is like God. Even Michael cannot be designated the first and the last. Because God says there is no one else. I am the first and I am the last. And you know that word first there? In Hebrew, it's Rishon. Rishon comes from the word Rosh. It's the same root as Bereshit, Rashit, the beginning. Now that sounds like it's common sense. I mean, first beginning. But look at it. In its word, it is firmly tied to Genesis 1 verse 1. In other words, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. What is the beginning? It's not just the beginning of time. It is a designation that says something about God himself. Now, if you look in the New Testament, in John, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And he was in the beginning with God, and all things were made by him, or through him, and without him there was not made one thing that was made. Jesus was the Father's vehicle through whom he created everything. And there's not one thing that exists that didn't come through Jesus. Even Satan himself was made through Jesus, which is for a person who doesn't understand the fact that Satan was, I like the way Arnold Fruchtenbaum calls it. He calls it that Satan had the power of contrary choice. I think that's how he phrased it. In other words, he was so powerful that even though he's made perfect, he had the ability, even though he was perfect, because he was so powerful, he had the ability to choose contrary to his own nature. And that's where evil came from. Evil didn't come from God. God never made anything to be wicked. Okay? God made everything that could be used for wickedness. And he never made anything wicked. If I put a knife in the hand of someone and tell him to kill someone, it's not the knife's fault, but the knife became the instrument of death. But the knife in itself is neutral. It was the intent that made that knife. Same with a gun. People are anti-guns. It's the person using the gun that's the problem, not the gun in itself, although it causes a lot of, there's one bullet, once it rips through you, you don't heal. I mean, it's really, really awful if you think about it. But that bullet by itself cannot do anything. It's the intent of the person shooting it. If we turn to Revelation 3, and we'll turn back to this, but to the Laodicean church, this is Jesus speaking. This is Jesus speaking. It says, "The Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God says this, I know your deeds." Jesus is the beginning of creation. The Greek word there is archi, which is the same word used in John 1 verse 1. In the beginning, which is rephrasing in Greek what was said in Hebrew in Genesis 1 verse 1. Jesus says he is the beginning of creation. Therefore, when you look back at Genesis 1 verse 1, when it says in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, you can understand that on one level as at the beginning of time, God created the heavens and the earth. On another level, you can understand it, you can translate it this way. By Jesus, God created the heavens and the earth. You can actually grammatically understand it that way. By Jesus. Jesus is the first word of the Bible. And find it very interesting that right at the end of the Bible, in Revelation, Jesus has the last words to say. He who testifies to these things says, yes, I am coming quickly. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. And again in verse 21 says, the grace of the Lord Jesus be with all. Amen. Jesus is right there in the first verse, and he's right there in the last verse. He is the beginning, and he is the end. In fact, in Revelation, I think it's chapter 1, verse 17, 17 and 18. Jesus appears to John. The amazing thing is John was the one that put his head on Jesus' chest. That's a sign of intimacy. You don't put your head on the chest of your enemy. You put it on the head of the on the chest of the one who is an intimate friend, because you're near his heart. And so John was so familiar with Jesus, walked with him. He was one of the three disciples that was the closest to Jesus. When they went up the Mount of Transfiguration, it was Peter, James, and John. The one who went into the high priestly court when Jesus was being tried as eyewitness of what was happening was John, because he was related to a priestly family. Peter followed him behind him, and he stayed in the courtyard. The reason we know what happened, one of the reasons we know what happened is not just because of the Pharisees that followed Jesus, it's also because John was there, he saw it. He saw the trial. And it says this, Jesus says, when I saw him, Jesus, And the whole description of Jesus is so different. It says, I fell at his feet like a dead man. Biblically, when someone falls down, biblically, every single case in Scripture from the beginning to the end, when someone of God falls down, they fall down as dead. There is no strength or life. It's almost like they are quaking and shaking in fear and that they cannot move. They can't get up. They are then strengthened by either the angel or the Lord himself. And they're told to stand on their feet. Ezekiel, when he was told to stand on his feet, the Holy Spirit then came into him and he stood on his feet. Why? Because when the person is filled with the Spirit, they have self-control. When he fell down, it wasn't because he was filled with the Spirit. It was because he just reacted to the awesome majesty of God. It was a reaction to the glory of God. And he fell down as dead. Didn't matter how he fell, on his face or on his back or whatever. He fell, boom, down. And he's possibly shaking. And that's why Jesus, it says, he placed his right hand on me. And that's what happens in with Ezekiel. A hand is placed on the shoulder to give them the power and the strength to stand up. And he says this, do not be afraid. This is the God that we serve. A God who, when we stand in his presence, we should be shaking in our boots. We should be in abject terror at his awesome majesty. For from him came all things, every atom. You split an atom, what do you get? Boom. That is the God that we serve. The tremendous power that is in his hands. That's the God that we serve. And he's the God that comes down and he touches us and he says, don't be afraid. Because God, the thing that we see in God is not his power primarily, but his heart. And he calms our fears and he bids us stand because God is gentle of heart. It's not in a contradiction to his holiness, perfectly united in himself. Jesus says, I am the first and the last and the living one, and I was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Jesus says, I am the first and I am the last. And yet God told us in Isaiah 44 that there is no other first and last. Which tells us Jesus is very God. You can't get around that. You cannot. You have to play absolute monkey tricks to get around that. And even when you do, it's so obvious that you're not getting around it. That's what it indicates. That's who Jesus is. He is God. It's very interesting in Scripture. There are three other Scriptures that speak about the beginning. There are three other Scriptures that speak about the beginning, probably a lot more, but the Jewish rabbis who read this, and this is why I'm bringing this out, not so that we learn about what the rabbis had to say. Well, the reason I'm bringing this out is this. The rabbis were speaking about Jesus, but they had no idea they were speaking about Jesus. That's what I find fascinating. When a rabbi says this, and you're like, but that's Jesus, but they don't see it. That is the mind of the cleverness of God, to testify about the Son through the mouths of people that don't even follow him. Think of Balaam. Balaam was not a true prophet of God. He was a pagan. And yet when Balaam spoke and the Holy Spirit came upon him, this pagan prophet testifies about the God of Israel and that you can't destroy them. Why does God do that? Because the alternative was he was going to curse. God stepped in to testify about himself. It does not validate Balaam. It doesn't mean, oh, let's follow Balaam. Oh, let's see if there's any other extant writings by Balaam. No, he's not God's prophet. But in that one time, God spoke through him. And the same is true here. They said, The Jews, when they read this, they said, on three things the world stands: on Torah, on the temple service, and on acts of kindness. You kind of think, well, how did they get that? Okay, so let's look at Proverbs 8:22. And it says, the Lord possessed me at the beginning of his way, before his works of old. The one who's speaking is wisdom. Wisdom says, the Lord possessed me at the beginning of his way. Literally, the Lord possessed me the beginning of his way. Rashit, the same word. So what they figured from the Hebrew text is, wisdom is the beginning of God's way. So that means, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In wisdom, God created the heavens and the earth. But wisdom was an embodiment of, in the Jewish mind, of the whole Bible. The Bible is God's wisdom. And so they said, Torah. What is Torah? We translate it as a law, God's law. But really, it's God's way. That's what it is. It's God's way. What he's done is he's... In the law, it's almost like, picture this, because it's very graphic language. It's someone with an archery bow, and he's pulling the string, and then along comes the law, and he says, no, move it that way. No, move it that way. He's training the guy to shoot. The law is a good teacher. That's what the word Torah means, teaching. It means training as if to shoot. The law is a good teacher, very good teacher. You can't get a better teacher in the Old Testament than the law. Your word is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. Oh Lord, how I love your law. I meditated on it day and night. Your commandments make me wiser than your enemy, than my enemies. I have more understanding than the elders, for I obey your precepts. Psalm 119 is all about the law. The problem is not with the law. The problem is with our arrows. Our arrows are bent. And therefore, the law teaches us all day long, but there's nothing the law can do until we get some straight arrows. And so when we shoot, we miss the mark. We sin, we miss the mark. So the law, the word of God, wisdom, God made the world through the word. And then in Jeremiah 17, verse 12. Jeremiah 17, verse 12 says, a glorious throne on high from the beginning is the place of our sanctuary. Literally, a glorious throne on high from the beginning, the place of us, of the sanctuary. There's no is there. It is, the beginning is the place of the sanctuary. Thus they said, on three things the world stands: on the law, on the temple service. The temple is regarded as the beginning in Jeremiah. And then the third thing, the tithes, are called the beginning, or the beginning of the fruit, in Deuteronomy 18, verse 4. I'm going to bring this together in the end, so you'll see where I'm heading. But Deuteronomy 18, verse 4 says this: you shall give him the first fruits of your grain, your new wine, and your oil, and the first shearing of your sheep. First fruits there is the same word, rashit. It's the first. The tithe, we got to understand the tithe. What was the tithe? Let me backtrack and say this. There is no church that I know of on the face of this earth that does tithing. And I've been in different churches, Anglican, visited Anglican, Pentecostal, Baptist, no church that I've ever seen tithes. They don't tithe. They call it tithing, but they don't. because you did not tithe money. Money was never tithed. Now, they gave money. There was a temple tax. When they went out of Egypt, they had all their gold. They gave it to the construction of the tabernacle. But that was not the tithe. The tithe was the 10% of your increase of all the crops and the sheep and everything that grew, that God blessed you with. And so that's why it says in Malachi, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be money in my house. No, that there may be food in my house. It was a feeding program. And there were different tithes. The one tithe that we just read about here, it talks about giving it to the priest. Then there was a tithe that you took and you ate your own tithe in Jerusalem every year to celebrate. But don't neglect the orphan, the widow, the priest. There's a tithe that every 3 years that you put in the center of your town, and the Levite, the orphan, the widow, the foreigner could come and take from it. The tithe was a feeding program. Why? Because God cares for the Levite and the orphan and the widow and the foreigner. Because God cares, it is acts of kindness. And so on three things that are the beginning in the Old Testament scripture, God created the world. The word, the temple service, and acts of kindness. How does that relate to us? All three, in some way, speak about Jesus. Jesus is the embodiment of the law. When you see Jesus, you see the reality of everything that the law is pointing to. Jesus is our sacrifice. See, what happens with the word is the word comes in and the word is light. And it exposes the darkness. And so through the revelation of God, we gain a revelation of ourselves. Thank the Lord that in the beginning, God created in the heavens and the earth. God founded the world on the temple service because Jesus was crucified before the creation, from the foundation of the earth. Jesus was crucified. So God already had it in his mind what was going to happen to Jesus. And God being eternal, it was almost like it was a present reality to him. The fall didn't take God by surprise. He knew, but he knew Jesus. He foreknew Jesus to die on the cross, and he chose his son to be the one to die for us. And so what we have here is we have the word, God's revelation, that we appropriate by faith. We have faith in what God has shown us, but also in what God has given to us. He's given to us a hope that Jesus came and died for us. And because of that death, therefore we can be made right with God, and therefore we are to live not as, but as Jesus in us. Paul said, it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And this is the thing about, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. If you turn back to Revelation chapter 3, the people in Laodicea were very self-sufficient, prosperous. They had everything they thought they needed. And this is what Jesus says to them. The Amen, the faithful and true witness. In other words, I see the reality. I look past all the pretense and everything that you're holding up, and I testify to that which I know is true. And it's scary because before men, we can look very righteous. And when we testify, generally, even this morning, I'm talking about myself, testify about all the good things. But we know where we fail, and we know where we're not right. And God is the faithful and true witness. He sees through all that outside padding. The Greek word aletheia for truth, aletheia, I love it. I love the Hebrew word, emet, but I love the Greek word. That's why it's so important to get the Greek as well. Because the word aletheia means this, unpretentious, unmasked reality. It is what it is. It is the way it is. That's what God sees. And so he says in verse 15, he says, the beginning of the creation of God says this, I know your deeds. I know your deeds, that you're neither hot nor cold. I wish that you were cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot or cold, I will spit you out of your mouth. Out of Jesus' mouth, he's going to spit them. Because you say, I am rich, and I have become wealthy, and I have need of nothing. And you do not know that you are wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. I advise you to buy from me gold refined by fire that you may become rich. And white garments that you may clothe yourself. And that the shame of your nakedness will not be revealed. And eye salve to anoint your eyes that you may see. Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. Therefore, be zealous and repent. They were so self-sufficient. They had everything. And Jesus says, no, you have nothing. Why? They're naked. They don't even realize they're naked. What does that remind me of? It reminds me of Genesis. Well, they knew they were naked. But the naked came from the disconnect from God through taking of the fruit. Through one man, sin came into the world, and death through sin. And Isaiah 59 verse 2, God says to Israel, your sins have made a separation between you and your God. From the separation of one who is life comes death, and death is separation from God. Why? Because life is this. John chapter 17 verse 3 says, this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and know Jesus Christ whom you have sent. Life is relationship with God. That is life. Anything else is just existence. Life is a relationship with God. To know him in relationship with him. Separated from that, we are naked, we are dead, we are blind, we have nothing. Jesus is the beginning of the creation of God. Let's bring this together. Jesus says, abide in me. And my word abide in you, and you'll bear much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Jesus is telling them, I am the beginning of creation. God says he's going to send a shaking on the earth. A shaking that's going to shake everything. But not only the things on earth, but also the things in heaven. Now, how does that relate to us? It's a shaking so strong that it threatens to shake and destroy that which is eternal. But it can't destroy that which is eternal. But that which is eternal is going to get tested. Not going to be spared. There's a shaking that's going to shake everybody. Only that which is eternal will remain. But only that which is eternal can be wrought in Jesus. In the creation, all things came through him. He's the beginning of the creation of God. If we want something to last forever, it needs to be a creation of God. If it's from self-will, self-effort, self-me, I think I can do this. God regards it as a nothing. Basically, God regards it. I have all this. I have all that. God says you have nothing. Before God, it's like it doesn't even exist. So we call Jesus the first. He's the beginning. And all things are made through him. And what is made through him stands forever. John 3, Jesus says this in the last few, in verses 18 to 20, he says, this is the verdict, that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than the light, because their deeds were evil. And they wouldn't come to the light for fear of their deeds being exposed. But he who loves truth comes to the light, so that what, let me read it, I don't want to misquote it, but that says here that it may be manifested, that's it. He who practices the truth comes to the light so that his deeds may be manifested as having been wrought, that means accomplished, in God. Those are the deeds that last for eternity. Those are the things that we can take with them, with us. There are many things in this earth we can't take with us when we die. But it talks about how blessed we are. If we die in Christ and we are living with Christ, and what we do has eternal significance. It says their deeds follow after them. We can take our works with us, but not our works. The works that are wrought in God, in Jesus. He is the beginning of the creation of God. And so we realize that He is the beginning and He is the end. Lastly, I want to just turn to Romans 1, verses 16 and 17. You see, on three things the world stands: on the law, on the temple service, and on acts of kindness. The law is the revelation of who God is. That brings the need of sacrifice because we have fallen, we have sinned. And so you have the temple worship. Jesus was slain from the creation of the world. But then it doesn't stop there. Jesus came to give us a life. Didn't come to give us an entrance. He came to give us a life. We talked about this yesterday. There is the gate and there is the way. Grant shared with us yesterday that about we need the true gospel. We need to know the true gospel. Why? Because the gospel is the gate. Or at least when we come and get saved, that's the gate. We come in the gate. But we don't stay at the gate. There is the narrow is the way that leads to life. And so Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. We've come to the Father, we know the Father, we're in relationship, and yet we're still walking the path. Paul says, "This I'm not saying I've arrived yet, but this I know. Forgetting what is behind, I press forward onto the higher call." I'm just paraphrasing it, but he's saying this. I'm not staying in the place that I am, but I have to press onward to the prize. Salvation is never static. It is dynamic, and it is a moment by moment walk with the Lord. And therefore, Jesus turns around this and says this, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Follow me, and he doesn't say go to Bible college. And I think Bible college is a good thing. And there's some Bible teachers I think would really benefit from going to Bible college. Because it would sharpen, that academic study would sharpen them. But Bible college does not make someone a pastor or a preacher. You don't study to be a pastor. I hate hearing that. No one studies to be a pastor. It's not like a job. You know, I'm studying to be an electrical engineer. It's not. It's a calling. God calls you. Whether you have that training or not, God calls you. The training is helpful. It's a good tool. It doesn't make you the preacher or the man of God. It's God. Jesus didn't say, go to missions college. Once you've done 3 years, then you can go on the mission field. He says, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. So when you're a fisher of men, you are fishing for men in Christ. Because he steps, and you step with him. And he steps by the voice of his Spirit. We're talking about Jesus, but it's the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of Christ. He steps. He speaks. We respond. He speaks. We respond. It's a relationship. Moment by moment. It's not about, well, what is the list that we need to write to prove that we are holy people? Oh, I don't smoke. I don't drink. I don't do this. I don't. And then we tick the list. Jesus is not interested in that. He's interested in a moment by moment walk with him. Listening to the voice of his Spirit. So this is what it says in Romans 1, verses 16 and 17. For I am not ashamed of the gospel. And that's why I can't relegate the gospel. This is why I can't relegate the gospel to just the gate. The gospel is also the way. Because it says here, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also the Greek. For in it, in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the righteous man shall live by faith. from faith to faith. That phrase, I think the NIV translates it or puts it in a much clearer way. I say NIV, but the NIV gets it right. I think I've got the right translation. It says from first to last. The righteousness of God is revealed in the gospel by faith from first to last. What that means is this. It's by faith here. It's by faith here. It's by faith here. It's by faith right till the end. And when we get to the end and we get our new body, this is what it says. These three things abide. Faith. What is faith? Faith is the ability to hear God, to hear Him, and to put your amen to Him, though you do not see it, and though everything around you screams it's a lie. But you hear God's voice, and you say, you are right. That's faith. Faith is the evidence of things not... faith is the evidence of things hoped for. The conviction of things hoped for. Let's read it, Hebrews 11. It should be an encouragement for you, if you're older, to see a younger person struggle with their memory. Yeah. And it says, Hebrews 11, verse 1, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. It is the assurance substance, i.e., substance as in a court of law. When you make a claim, if your claim is true, it will have substance. Not substance as in a tangible substance. That's false word of faith teaching. It's not like electricity. That's not what it's saying. It's saying it has substance to it. It's not an empty boast. It's a reality. But it's of things hoped for. And what it's hoped for is not something you experience right now. It's still coming. The word, I think it's kavah in Hebrew. You can correct me if I'm wrong. Kavah means to hope and to wait. It's something that is still coming. The conviction, the evidence of things not seen. That's faith. You put your amen, even though you can't see it, and even though everything around you screams that it's a lie. But I heard God tell me this. I know God said this. And because God said it, I believe it. That is faith. It comes not from my desire and what I want, and I wish I had a car, and I wish I had this. It comes from the very revelation of God, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the word of Christ. Revelation, the word. But we have hope because of the cross and the death and the resurrection of Jesus. And this, when we accept Jesus, He infuses us with Jesus' life. I give Him my corrupt, rotten, ugly life, and He gives me Jesus' righteous, pure, godly life. It's a swap, but it's an unfair swap. It doesn't even give it justice, but it's like I've got a 1400 Datsun from 1971, and it's not even working. And there's a guy who has a brand new Ferrari who says, let's do a swap here. I'll give you this Ferrari if you give me your Datsun. It's not even a fair comparison, because what we have in Christ is far greater than anything you can compare on this earth. And what we have to give Him in that exchange is far more rotten and corrupt and ugly than that Datsun. But Jesus says, give me your life, and I'll give you my life. That's why it's called grace. It's a free gift. And so now there's an exchange. I no longer live. Christ lives in me. That old person is dead on the cross. Taken to the cross. The life I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. And so I'm saying here is this. The life of Jesus needs to be flowing through our veins and bringing about those acts of kindness, so that our deeds are not like the Laodicean deeds, which were done in self-confidence and in self-reliance. But what we do for each other and for the world out there, when we share the gospel, whatever we do, it's all done in Jesus. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. But he's not just the beginning. He's not just the first. He's also the last. And therefore, everything that is done right up to the end, for it to be classed as the creation of God, that which is going to last for eternity, has to be done in him. What is our response this morning? Lord, I cannot do this. There's nothing good in my flesh. Lord, I need you. Without you, I am nothing and I can do nothing. Help me, Lord. If that is our response this morning, God is going to do wonderful, amazing, eternal things through you and me that are going to count for eternity. When God sees, he's not going to see a nothing. He's going to see a something. And isn't that why, if we do it in him, so he calls us and we respond, and he calls us and we respond. And I did this with Di at St. Luke's. So here am I, and I'm resisting God, and I'm like this. And God says, no, come this way. And no, no. And then I think, no, I repent. Okay, Lord, you're right, I'm wrong. And then I repent. Just like when I got saved. Lord, no, you're right, I'm wrong. I turn. There's a turning, a change, a fundamental shift. And so I'm following the Lord. And then again, like that song, prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. And then the Holy Spirit's, and I respond. For every single thing we do for the Lord that lasts, he gives us a reward. And this is the amazing thing. When we get that reward, I believe we're going to be like the 24 elders before the throne, putting it at the feet of Jesus. Why? Lord, that was not me. I was going the other way. You were on at me and on at me and on my case. And then I just decided, but Lord, it was you. It was you. It was you. And we'll put our thrones before the throne. And you know what the Lord's going to say? He's going to say, it's yours. It is yours. How can I say that? Because it says, build for yourself treasures in heaven where rust cannot destroy. They run for a perishable wreath. We for an imperishable. We're going to keep it forever. We're going to put it at the throne, at the feet of Jesus, and Jesus is going to say, no, it's yours. And we're going to say, but Lord, I don't even deserve this. It was all you. It was you all the way. And Jesus is going to say, but I want you to keep this. Jesus is the beginning of the creation of God, and he is the end.